The Savior say, "Thy strength in weakness born, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thy open door." Jesus, baby born, born to give thy own sin and death and crimson stain, be born. Oh, now in need I find thy power and thy alone can change the lover's hearts and melt the hardest stone. Jesus made him one. Jesus made it all, born to live my own. Sin and death the crimson stain, be washed in white as snow. Be washed in white as snow. Be washed in white as snow. Praise the one who made my death and raised us by love from the dead. Oh, praise the one who made my death and raised us by love from the dead. Oh, praise the one who made my death and raised us by love from the dead. Oh, praise the Jesus paid him all to give my own sin and left the crimson stain, he washed in white as snow.
Messages and everything for with you. Lift up Pastor Steve this morning. as he shares a message that he's prepared. Lord, they're not his words, they're yours. Let us connect to their words. Lift up Steve, give him peace, give him strength, give him enthusiasm, give him whatever he needs to let people know that they're your words for them, for all of us, for him himself as he's preaching them. Give him strength, Lord, for you and not for him. Lord, there's other people in the world this morning. Lift up Naomi this morning, who's dealing with migraines constantly. A lot of us don't know what that's like, and we never will. And we're thankful for that, but we lift her up to you. Desperately wants to go to a full day of school. Desperately wants to come to church and seek you. And has those problems. We don't know what their answers are, Lord. We ask you to lift up doctors. We ask you to lift up specialists. And we ask you to lift up our faith and her faith so that we can look to you to be comforted, to be healed, to be whatever is needed to get closer to you. Lord, grant her those things this morning. Grant her some peace. I ask you that. I stand in place of her and I ask for some peace for her. Thank you how you love us like no one else can and no one else ever will. Let her feel that love today. I ask that for everyone else here in this room, that we would feel your love like we've never felt any love before. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning once again.
Good morning.
Good morning. Can you imagine being dropped off in the middle of the wilderness with no compass, no map, no GPS? How many of you would find your way out? John said he would. You know, maybe John's an experienced survivalist. You know, he'd be able to just kind of check the stars or the landscape and see where the sun is, see how the moss is growing, just be able to find his way out because he'd kind of be able to navigate a little bit. But I think most of us would not. I've been kind of stumbling around in the forest out in Pennsylvania with my brother sometimes, and he knew his way around, and for fun, he would kind of like leave me. And he'd kind of slip away unexpectedly because he knew the path that went this way, and I was looking at something over here or something, and then he'd just kind of hide and he'd kind of see what I would do to see if I could figure out where I was. Whatever, he had a lot of fun with that, but I didn't. But have you ever felt like there's times in your life when you're like that, you just kind of feel stranded and you just can't figure out what direction to go or what to do, where to turn? And I think it may surprise us that our God has provided everything we need to find our way forward on this path of life that we're involved in. To find our way forward on a life of godliness and spiritual success. And I think if we were to spend some time asking the question, what's the biggest issue that every single one of us face? If we were to sit down and start asking that, and you would share your thoughts and I would share my thoughts, I think we'd come up with a lot of questions and a lot of issues that we face, but I'm not sure any one of them would be the final perfect one. But I think that every single one of them would contain this word, pressure. See, we have all kinds of pressure on us today. We are under pressure, so to speak. We are under financial pressure. We're under social pressure. We're under psychological pressures. We're under health pressures. Under pressure. Today I begin a new series for the next few weeks, and it's titled Under Pressure. I was kind of disappointed when Zach wasn't here. He loves to fiddle around with my bass. So he's a really good bass player. And I was going to have him play do 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 ding ding under pressure. Because we're all under pressure. And for the next few weeks, we're going to get our way through this course of study to see how we can navigate our lives as experienced survivalists, that we can find our way out of the woods when we get left there, so to speak. And we begin today with a message called The Promise. And I'll begin reading our scripture text in 2 Peter chapter 1. So if you'd like to open up your Bibles or your scripture apps to 2 Peter, we're going to dig into that passage in just a moment. But I want to introduce this by just telling you a little story. It's a story about a little fish. He's about that big. And it's called the Mariana snailfish. And the Mariana snailfish lives in the deepest caverns of the ocean. He lives in the Mariana shelf. And it's a place where the pressure is 1,000 times greater than it is for us here on the surface. It's a place where the temperature where this little fish lives is near freezing, and there's no light because it's so deep in the ocean. It's the deepest part of the ocean. And God created this little fish about the size of our human being to thrive in those extreme conditions at the bottom of the ocean. And you might ask, well, how do they do that? I mean, how does this little fish survive at the bottom of the ocean where the pressure is so great? And this little snailfish possesses special features, like he has flexible bones, and his skull is flexible, and he produces a distinct chemical that stabilizes his structure and the pressure inside of him. Now get this, God created this little fish so that the pressure inside of him is greater than the pressure outside of him, so that they can live in comfort where the pressure is 1,000 times greater than what it is here for us. And that made me think of this question, how can we as believers create sort of a spiritual pressure on the inside that's so strong that it makes it possible for us to live in the world with all these external pressures on us. Pretty amazing that God would create this little fish in such a way, but think about this. The God who created this little fish to live in the bottom of the ocean, where the pressure is 1,000 times greater, creates us in the same way that we too can live under pressure. He built us that way. And so today in our scripture text in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, John always tells you what it is in the Pew Bible, but I don't have a Pew Bible at home, so I don't know what page it is. It's page 1899 in my Bible. But I know a lot of you just look on your phone, so it's not even on a page. You just go there. But 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, it says this. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. God bless the reading of his word this morning. And according to Peter, those of us who walk alongside Jesus have been given everything we need for a life of godliness. That's what the scripture said. Not some of the things you need, not many of the things, not even most of the things that you need. But he's pretty specific there. He says, everything we need. Believe it or not, God has already provided you and I the resources we need to confidently live the life that we are created to live. Pretty amazing, isn't it? So what specifically are those resources? What has God given us? And that's what we're going to dig into this scripture. And it starts with, number one, access to God's power. Peter tells us that we have access to the power of God. That's the best news that we could ever have today, because we don't have to do this thing by ourselves. We don't have to face the pressures of life in our own strength. And in fact, if we do, it's kind of a bit discouraging, because we're not sufficient in our own strength to face life under pressure. These pressures that we face sometimes are way beyond what you and I can handle in our own personal human strength. And that's why Peter begins this little discussion about everything we need by introducing us again to the incredible power of God. He says, by his divine power, we have been given everything we need. Isn't that cool? So let's unpack what Peter means by this. What does he mean that we have God's power? And under God's power, the first thing that we can see is that God's power is unlimited. God's power can light up the universe. It can fire up the stars, power the planets, move the oceans in their tides, give life to every single creature on earth. And you know what? He doesn't even get diminished by 1 kilowatt. There is no problem, there is no situation in life for which God's power is not adequate. You will never have a problem that's too big for God's power. You may think you're in the middle of one right now, and it's possible because we just don't really comprehend or understand God's power. But God is able to do above and beyond all we could ever ask or think. And through his power, we don't have to be victims. We can be victorious because God's power is unlimited. The second thing we can see about his power is that it's unleashed. You see, when we get Jesus into our life, when we become a Christian, like Jesse was talking about in his prayer, when we become a Christian, the power of God Almighty is turned on in our life. With God, all things are possible. All things. And I did a little Bible study on those two words, all things. You know, that's in the Bible a lot. And it's in a lot of Bible verses that we really should be committing to memory, verses that we should know, like Romans 8:28. And I found it really interesting. Sue was doing her Bible study for Wednesday night, and this Bible verse comes up in your ladies' Bible study on Wednesday night. So Romans 8:28, go home and learn. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God. See, he makes it available to all of us, all things. And you may be sitting there thinking right now this morning, well then, why isn't it that this power isn't working in my life, in my situation, in my pressure? If God has given me all this power, then what's wrong with me? And I'll tell you, even as a pastor, there's times I'm saying that, you know, like, okay, God, where's your power working in this situation? And we'll get to that. So why are we not living this powerful life that I'm talking about this morning? And we're going to get there in a moment, but before we get there, I want you to understand, as I've tried to comprehend this in my own life, that the power that we need has been given to us by Almighty God. It's there. It's available. Peter said that. His divine power is available. I mean, do we need joy? Do we need a part of happiness that comes from Christ? I mean, I've literally watched people go through some of the most horrendous things in life that they could ever have, and they do so with a smile on their face because they have joy in their heart. And I sit there and go, how in the world are you doing that? It's not on their strength. It's on God's power. Philippians 4:13 says, you can do all things through whom? Through Christ who strengthens you. Not through me trying to struggle through it on my own. That's where we get into trouble. God's power is unlimited, and it's unleashed. It goes to work the moment you become a Christian. And here's the last thing about the power of God. It's unlocked. Our text verse says this, through our knowledge of him who has called us by his own glory in goodness. In other words, the power of God comes to you through your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. When he comes into your life, when you've invited him into your heart, when you've confessed your sin like Jesse talked about, the Holy Spirit now comes and lives within, and you're connected with Almighty God, and you can build on that relationship. And you can see the power of God come alive in your life. So the first thing that God wants to give us is his power. The second bullet point that we get to is that we look at what I want to call for my text message, his promise. You see, we have God's promises. Peter says in verse 4, through these he has given us his very great and precious promises. And I want to give you a little illustration, a little visual here. Imagine this. We have over here the power of God. I want you to just kind of think in your mind a huge generator. I mean, like kind of like a Hoover Dam size generator. I don't know how many of you have ever seen pictures of that or ever been there yourself. But the Hoover Dam size generators, they can like fill up this area where all these pews are. One generator. That's the power of God. So we have the power of God over here that's this big, huge generator, and we have little old me standing over here. Now, I'm not very big compared to that. How do little old me get connected to that? And the Bible is very clear. It says this: we get connected with God's power source by his very great and precious promises. God's power is not available apart from Scripture. If you want the power of God to be working in your life, we cannot ignore the book. Amen? And you know, I get a lot of Christians come and talk to me about what's happening in their life, and even for myself. Now, I've been walking with God for a while, I'm your pastor. Even with myself, there are times I struggle with pressures of life. But the question I usually ask someone that's struggling is, I say, do you read the Bible? Well, no, I really don't have a lot of time for that. Well, you know what? If we don't spend time in the Word, we can't complain about not being connected to the power. Because it's just like there's wires connecting between you and God, and those wires carry the power of God from him to you to me. And where are those wires? Those wires are God's precious promises. And why does Peter call them exceedingly great and precious? Well, they're great for one reason, simply because they come from a great and powerful God. And they lead to an awesome life. But these promises are great for at least three additional reasons and things that we want to focus on this morning. Number one, God's promises, they're incalculable. That's kind of a strange word that we don't use too often anyway. But we fully can count the promise. No one can fully count the promises of God. There's thousands of them in there. There's 100,000 of them in there. I dare you to try and count how many promises you can count in just an hour. Somewhere in every single book of the Bible, in every single chapter, there are great evidences of God's promise. It's a book full of promises. Just think about it. If you want to hear what God has to say to your heart, if you want to know what God's word wants to say to your heart, if you want to hear what's in store for you, if you want to know what God has promised for you, there's only one place to get it. It's between the covers of this book. So one of the reasons why you want to get involved in the promises of God is because there's so many of them. They're incalculable. And you can spend the rest of your life and you'll probably never get through all of them. I know some of you have been walking with the Lord for a long time. And I'll bet you're still learning new promises every day. The second reason why these promises are so important, they're not only incalculable, but they're infallible. God's promises are great because they are always true. Here's what the Bible says about God's promises in 2 Corinthians 1:20. The Bible says, "For every one of God's promises is yes in Christ. Therefore, through him, we say amen to the glory of God." What a tremendous word. In other words, God has promised to never leave us or forsake us, and all things can work out for our good because God says yes, and we can say amen. So we love his promises because there's so many of them. They're incalculable. We love his promises because he never breaks them. And thirdly, we can love his promises because they're always available to us. There's a little word that Peter loves to use. He kind of writes it in this book, and he uses it in several others. And it's the word precious. Now, what do we mean when we say precious? I'll tell you what we did. Now when Tracy, my daughter, my youngest daughter, first got her little puppy, she called him Benny. We call him Benny for short. And we knew Trisha's older dog. Most of you know our dogs. But Trisha's, we wondered if Trisha's golden retriever would accept little Benny. And we kind of thought he would, because Tucker's kind of gentle and good. And he's good with other dogs. And so, but one day Sue got this picture sent to her phone. And you know what my wife said? Oh, that's precious. But I want to tell you, this is not what Peter's talking about when he says we have God's precious promises. That's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about teddy bears or precious babies or when we say, oh, that's just so precious. No, he's talking about precious in a different way. Not in a sentimental way, but think precious stones. How many precious stones can you think about this morning? And not only think precious stones, think precious metals. Think gold. That's an extremely precious metal. It's precious not only because God made it, and God buried it in the earth, and he loves it so much that one day he's going to pave the streets of the New Jerusalem with it. That's going to be awesome. And experts say that gold has this chemical properties that no other metal has. Gold cannot be destroyed by water. It cannot be destroyed by time. It cannot be destroyed by fire. It's malleable, which means it can spread without cracking. It's ductile, which means it stretches without breaking. And it's rare. You know how rare gold is in this world? I was shocked when I read this. But they actually say that all of the gold that's ever been mined in the whole entire world could fit into two Olympic-sized swimming pools. Now, that's a lot of gold. Think about the size of an Olympic swimming pool full of gold. But I was just shocked that that's all the gold there is. I mean, people have been looking for gold for a long time, but whenever you watch the gold rush shows, what do they find? That much. You know, and you see, they got it stored in there as the bricks. They got all these stacks of gold. But start stacking all those little blocks of gold into an Olympic-sized swimming pool. It's a lot of stacks. So there's not a huge amount of gold. And we call it a precious metal. And what Peter is talking about here, about every one of God's promises that he issues to us in his word, they're as precious as gold. They're so valued that just one of those promises in the word scriptures can make you infinitely richer than somebody who owns all the gold in both of those swimming pools. You believe that this morning? I believe that if we could get a hold of the right promise in the right situation, it'll change everything that you and I have, everything about our lives. And we don't have to go digging in Alaska for it. We have it right here in our hands. The precious promises of God we carry with us in church every week. And a lot of times, we just lay those promises down on the shelf for all we want. And we don't go back and dig one up when we need it. And I'll tell you what, I was struggling with something this week. And I was like, you know what? Practice what you preach, brother. Go get the word. Find a promise that deals with that and claim it. And I was convicted of that, because sometimes we read the word at night, and as we read this book and we recognize the life-changing gifts that God has given us, and we understand these things, and we just can't believe them sometimes. But Peter says, they're here. We just got to dig them up. And Peter wants us to understand that we don't have to wait for these. We don't have to do anything to get them. We don't have to sign up for them. There's no class that we can go to learn about them. God has given us everything we need through his great and precious promises. And it's interesting that we have this, and God has given it to us. It's his precious book. But instead of going to the precious book where we have all the promises from God, if we'll only just connect to it, we run around to seminars, we look up things on the internet, on Google, and say, oh, I wonder how I can deal with this. I better Google it. And we see what somebody says on the internet. Oh, this is how you deal with that pressure. Instead of going to God's word. But there's nothing wrong with doing those things. There's nothing wrong with listening to tapes that tell you how to deal with things. But if we do that, if all we do is Google it, with the exclusion of reading the book where the real gold is, we're just messing with our own lives. And then one day we look up and wonder, why is this working? Because it's not going to work unless we follow the plan. So let me encourage you that we have God's power. It's been given to us by Almighty God, who is himself power, think generator. You have this great and precious promises, think gold. They're given to you in this book. The gold that's kind of like the electric wires that connects you from here to the generator. Just thought of this, those wires are made of gold. If you want the power of God, we have to be in the book. There's no such thing as being a powerful Christian without being the book. That's the secret. And here's the last one. We have God's purpose. What is God doing in your life? Why is he doing all this? Why does God provide us with his divine power and his precious promises? Because he wants to do something in our lives. He has a purpose in mind for me, and he has a purpose in mind for you. Listen to what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 3, or 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who has called us for his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises. For what? So that through them, you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of the world by evil desires. Now, those are some wordy statements, so let's just unpack them a little bit. Through the promises of the nature of God that's within you, it's growing in opposition of your old nature. The new nature is now being fed. How's it being fed? Through the book. Through the promises, we get connected with the power of God, with the nature of God that's now within us, if we've accepted Christ as Savior and the Holy Spirit comes and lives within. The Bible says when you do that, number one, you should become more godly. And number two, he promises that you will do that and you will escape the old nature, the old sinful human nature, that's the corruption in the world by its evil desires. So let's just pause for a minute and ask ourselves, what in the world does that mean? And I need to be careful here, because when I'm not careful, I'll say things that can get me into trouble. So I'm going to be really careful. See, the world that we live in, this world is no longer capable of communicating positive things to our lives. It's really not. I mean, you may have a positive family, and I think I have a positive family, and we may have this positive little group. But the world as we know it, especially here in the United States, is no longer a world that values virtue or goodness. The Bible says that there will come a time when we'll call evil good and good evil. And I'll tell you what, we're at that time. And all you have to do is look around or watch. It's just so evident. So here we are as believers. We're connected to this power source. We've been given these divine promises. But how in the world are we supposed to live in this world where we live? The Bible says that you and I as believers have called to live righteous lives in the midst of a culture that is not righteous, and even more and more so, it's actually condemning us for being righteous. We cannot be absorbed into this culture. We have to be different. So how do we do that? You have to do it through the power of God. How do we get the power of God? Through the great and precious promises. They're in the book. And you download them into your heart. And you say, okay, Pastor, I got that. That was a good message. But how do I download this stuff? So I got a little short four-point conclusion. As Roy brings it up on the screen, there it is. Number one, analyze. Two, personalize. Three, memorize. And four, verbalize. See, step one is to analyze. If you're feeling a little bit powerless in some area of your life as a Christian, take inventory. Where are you lacking power? Is it, you're lacking power because you're being hateful? Are you lacking power because you don't have any joy? Where are you lacking power? Take inventory. Where do you need God's word to help you? See, the word of God was meant to help us with very personal things. So the first thing we have to do is analyze. The second one we have to do is personalize it. What does that mean? Well, now that we've analyzed it and we know where we need God's help, we have to start finding promises in the Word of God that deals with the challenge that we're facing. How do we get God's power and integrate it into the things we do, we're dealing with? It's going to be through a scripture. So connect your life with a power source. Analyze. See, here's what my need is. Then we personalize it. Here's what the scripture is that deals with that. And all right, now this one's going to kill you. Memorize. How many of you know that there's tremendous value in memorizing scripture? And how many of you say, man, I just can't do that? I've heard that over and over and over again. And I've said it myself. But you know what? I can recite to you word for word something that I heard 50 years ago on a record album from the Moody Blues that started out, "Of course you are, my bright little star. Five miles and miles of files, three files of your forefathers' fruit, and now to suit our great computer, your magnetic ink." It was the opening lyrics to the song "Threshold of a Dream" of the Moody Blues. And I haven't heard that for 50 years, but I can still recite that. So I have to look in my own brain and say, you can't memorize a scripture verse? Come on. Every single one of you, if I say this commercial, or John brought up a bunch of commercials last week, and things, if I say this, you'll recite the end. Because we can't memorize. But we've allowed the enemy to say, oh, I can't memorize scripture. Memorize. The psalmist said this, "Your word I've hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." See, when we memorize the Bible, we make God's word portable. We can't always carry this book around with us. But when we carry bits of scripture along with us, it goes wherever you go. And most of us, we have issues in life that are instantaneously. Momentary. We've got some stuff on our hard drive, and just if we just take one simple verse, one verse that deals with what you're dealing with, and we memorize that verse, and we call it the memory when we need it, no matter where you are or what time it is, you've got it. So here's the first one, and I rarely hear anyone talk about this. We analyze, we personalize, we memorize, and the fourth one is to verbalize. If you want to make God's promises stick to your ribs of your spiritual being, find ways of sharing them with others. Speak them out loud. See, because it's one thing to tell God about your problems, but sometimes we need to tell our problems about God. Great and powerful God who's bigger than our problems that we're connected with. And when we do that, we neutralize the problem, the situation. We unload the pressure. So figure out what you're dealing with. Analyze it. Personalize it. find the right scripture, memorize it, go beyond what the enemy's telling you. You can do it. Put it on a little sticky note, stick it in front of your mirror, read it. Read it over and over like you were listening to a song. And I'll bet you in a week you have it. And then tell somebody else. Because as soon as we start telling somebody else, it's easier for us to remember the promise. Stand with us. The prayer is that as we work through these lessons in this section of scripture, that it will dawn on us that the deepest part of life that we need, God has already done for us through his great and precious promises. He's given us everything we need.
Talk that I don't walk and miss the moments right before my eyes.